Egypt. Then, ineluctably receding, splitting, disintegrating, until by the end of the 5th century AD, the Eastern Empire is left stewing in its own incense, while the Western lands are fragmented into inchoate kingdoms of Goths, Vandals, Burgundians, Franks, Angles, Saxons, and lesser bandits. The successive maps of Islam are also there, rushing headlong out of the Arabian desert in all directions to India, the Danube Valley, around North Africa into Spain and the middle of France, then falling back phase by declining phase. The ebb and flow of Mongol hordes and Ottoman Turks are duly translated into their space-time coordinates. Because this atlas was made when the westernized, straight-line, ancient, medieval, modern historical perspective still prevailed over the historical pluralism made familiar by Spengler and Toynbee, it makes only minor display of the civilizations that flourished far from the Mediterranean basin. But successive maps of the empires and civilizations of China, India, and Central America would have shown the same general forms and space-time cycles. Leafing through an historical atlas of this sort, we see history as if through a multiple polarizing glass that reduces the infinite human variety to a single rigorous dimension. Effective political control over acreage. This dimension is unambiguously represented by a single clear color, red, green, yellow, blue, imposed on a particular segment of the outlying world. The red on Italy, Gaul, Spain, Egypt means Roman rule. The blue means Parthian rule. The uncolored fringes mean the amorphous anarchy of barbarism. What of our own Western civilization, then, viewed through this unsentimental lens? More than half the pages of this old atlas of mine are used to chart its course. In the 7th and 8th centuries, its birth pangs can be seen succeeding hard on Rome's death agonies, until the West is shown plainly alive and breathing in the compact purple that marks the Carolingian Empire about 814 AD. From then on, it moves unceasingly outward over the globe from its West European heartland. In the 15th century, it bursts from West Europe and the Mediterranean into Africa, Asia, the Americas, Oceania, and all the seas. The last map in my Atlas's Western series, a double-size inserted page is needed for it, is entitled Colonies, Dependencies, and Trade Routes, 1914. And there before your eyes, you can see at once that in AD 1914, the domain of Western civilization was, or very nearly was, the world. True enough, in many regions the Western dominance was only external. The local societies had not been westernized, or only superficially so. The peoples were subjects rather than citizens of the West. But still, the West held the power. It held the power in Western Europe itself, original home of the civilization, and in Central Europe, in both Americas, over all Africa, Oceania, and much of Asia. Japan was outside the Western domain, though there had been Western intrusions. China, too, was largely outside, though the system of concessions and enclaves had turned many of the most important areas of China into at least semi-dependencies of the West. The case of Russia is harder to classify. Peter the Great, the Napoleonic Wars, the Holy Alliance, and the influence of Western ideas and technology had brought her in some measure within the Western concert of nations. But the combination of Byzantine, Asiatic, and barbarian strains in her culture had prevented her from becoming organically a part of the West, while her strength and remoteness had fended off Western conquest. With these exceptions, or partial exceptions, plus a few oddities like Afghanistan and Ethiopia, all of which together would have seemed to a galactic observer almost too trivial to note, the planet, water, and land, at the start of the First World War, belonged to the West. My atlas ended there, but as I closed it that morning and replaced it in its dark corner, my imagination was automatically carrying the series of maps forward over the intervening 5 decades. Territories and possessions of the major powers in 1920, at the founding of the League of Nations, Eastern Europe at the conclusion of the Second World War, Asia and Oceania in 1949, after the communist conquest of mainland China, decolonization of Africa in the period of 1951 through the 1960s.